Hello everyone. So up to the previous videos, we have gone through all the parts of the forebrain. We have explained how the forebrain works and the different parts of the forebrain, like the cerebrum, diencephalon, limbic system. So all these things we have discussed. And after the clarity of those particular systems, I want to finish off that brain's structure, in detail structure, with the next part. Okay, so if anyone have missed watching those videos, please make sure that you complete watching them, because only then you'll understand these points. So coming to today's topic, there's a video on midbrain. So the name itself indicates this is the middle portion of the brain. So it shows that this is the middle portion of brain. So many people ask me some questions, where is the position, actual position of this midbrain? The actual position of the midbrain is below the forebrain. So when you observe the brain from the dorsal side, not from the ventral side or from the sagittal view, when you observe from the dorsal side, you can see that we are having cerebrums on the top. So we have the cerebrums here, this is the corpus callosum. And below the cerebrum here, we'll have the midbrain part. So midbrain is properly visible when, you know, we just elongate the brain and put it in a dorsal way, straight way. Then only you'll understand where the midbrain is. But when you observe normally, we can see midbrain posterior to the cerebrum. So if I say, for example, if I draw, this is a cerebrum. So this is a cerebrum. And you know the obvious diagram which we generally use, that is the corpus callosum. So here we have the corpus callosum part, assume we have the corpus callosum here. Then we have the epithalamus. So here we have the epithalamus, and we have the thalamus, and we have the hypothalamus, just a rough way. Okay, so at the dorsal portion of the epithalamus, we have the pineal body. So here we have the pineal body, and just below this one, that means from the back side, just below this one, we can have, or we can observe the midbrain, which is having some lobes. So we can see midbrain here, and we can also see the nerve tracts coming through this hypothalamus. So we can see some nerve tracts coming through this hypothalamus, which also constitute a part of brain. So the midbrain comes through this thalamus. So if you observe, if this is a thalamus, the midbrain, the cerebrum will come through the thalamus down as midbrain. So this thing we have to understand it properly. So the reason, I mean, some people would say it is above or below. So actually, if the hypothalamus is like this, it will be like this hypothalamus. It will be having optic chiasma. If you remember the optic nerves tract, we have the optic chiasma here. So if you form the optic chiasma, which one? The hypothalamus. So in this optic chiasma, between, we have a gap. So through this gap, the midbrain parts will come down. And moreover, the midbrain parts are only two. We have two midbrain parts. One is called as the corpora quadrigemina, the blue colored one, which is having lobes. So you can see in a sagittal view, this is a sagittal view. In a sagittal view, you can see that the midbrain is located posterior to the thalamus, or we can say dorsal to the thalamus. Okay, so when you observe this dorsal to the thalamus midbrain, you can see that there are actually four lobes. You can see two in this view. If you observe this view, if you put up this view, the dorsal view, so if this is a cerebrum or cerebral hemispheres, and below the cerebral hemisphere, you can see the midbrain having four lobes. You can observe four lobes, two on each side. So these are two lobes and these are the two lobes. So you can observe two on each side. Now, this one is the same. We have a sagittal view. So you have cut it like this and you are observing one side. That's why you can observe only two lobes here. But actually it is having how many lobes? Four lobes. So that's why the first part of midbrain is considered, or it is called as, I'll write with blue color. So it is called as corpora quadrigemina. So this part, which is present, I can say, posterior to thalamus or dorsal to thalamus, it is called as corpora quadrigemina. So here Corpora means what? Corpora means a body, corpus, body. So corpora or corpus means a body. Quadri, that means how many? Four. So it is having how many lobes? Four lobes. And gemina means, actually it's a Latin word which means twins. So gemina means twins. So if you try to observe this meaning of this word, you get the structure of the corpora quadrigemina. So when you observe, so I'll just, what I'll do is I'll just put this in a zoomed view. So we'll just take this and we'll observe. So when you observe this corpora quadrigemina, you'll have two lobes on one side. So you'll have the two lobes on one side. You have the two lobes on the other side. And the point here is, these two look like twins. So you have four, that's why quadri, four lobes. And they are like twins. So this is twins number one, this is twins number two. That's why they said quadrigemina, four lobes which look like twins. So four lobes which are twins, you can say, or which look like twins. Okay. So that is the corpora quadrigemina meaning. So interestingly, in zoology, the easiest way is understanding its etymology, the meaning. So if you understand the meaning, we don't need to mug up the structure. So if you know this meaning, corpora quadrigemina, so it is a body which is having four lobes and which look like twins. So we are having four lobes. Now, as I have said, two lobes look similar and two lobes look similar. The upper two lobes are called as superior colliculi. So superior means upper, and the lower two are called as inferior colliculi. Again, as I have said, if you observe the etymology of this word, colliculi, colliculi means hills. So in Greek language, colliculi means hills. So assume they look like hills. So they are like hills. They are like some mountains on the sides of the brain or the back of the brain. So they look like hills. That's the reason why they are called as colliculi. Superior hills region and inferior hills region. So that is the structure. Now, what are their functions? What is the function of this superior colliculi or inferior colliculi? So superior colliculi are concerned with the sensory nerves coming from the eyes. So sensory nerves coming from the eyes will pass through this superior colliculi. Now, what is the function of this superior colliculi? So first, if you observe the general function of corpora quadrigemina, the general function is relaying of signals. So I write here the general function. What is the normal function totally? It is relaying of signals. Relaying of signals from the hind parts to the upper parts of brain, from the lower parts to the upper parts of brain. That's the actual function of the midbrain, or we can say the corpora quadrigemina. So fortunately, what happened is, the superior colliculi will encounter the optic sensory nerves, the nerves coming from your eyes. So optic sensory nerves will pass through. As I said, we have the optic chiasma here. They will go through this top part of midbrain, superior colliculi, and they'll reach the, which part? They'll reach the back lobe of the cerebrum, that is the occipital lobe. Okay. So now, as the things are going through this one, this superior colliculi has one function, that is the visual reflexes. This superior colliculi will control something called as visual reflexes. So what is meant by this visual reflexes? Simple thing, visual reflexes are something which will make your head arrange according to the focus. For example, the superior colliculi, what is motor functions? Yes, they get the sensory nerves from the eyes, that's true, it gets the signals there, that's okay. But what are its motor functions? Motor functions is they produce visual reflexes. They have connection with the head muscles also. So they have a link with the head muscles. So nerves coming out of this midbrain has the link with the head muscles as well as the visual reflexes. So now, basically, what is meant by this visual reflex? For example, when you want to focus on an object, for example, I'm trying to focus on the camera right now. What's happening? My head muscles are turning and my eyes are being involuntarily focused on the camera. So if you want a clear focus on anything, we require this visual reflexes. And that visual reflexes are under control of the superior colliculi. So, for example, I'm right here. I want to look what's happening here. Automatically, my eyes, my head will rotate. Okay. So, with a reflex action, it will rotate, and the eyes will be focused involuntarily. All the muscles inside the eye will focus involuntarily on the place where we want to do, and that is the main function. That is the definition of the visual reflexes. So, you want to see something. Automatically, your head and your eyes will rotate without your knowledge, and focusing will also happen without your knowledge. That is the basic function of the superior cortical. So your visual cortex is occipital, that's true. But how the signals goes there or how the vision will be going to that part is because of the focusing of the eyes or the muscles present in eyes, which are again in control of the visual reflexes, which is done by the superior colliculi of the midbrain. In the same way, the inferior colliculi, what happens? In inferior colliculi, we have auditory reflexes. So in the inferior colliculi, what do we have? Means we have the auditory reflexes. So auditory reflexes. So again, auditory means what? Which involves ear. So obviously, midbrain have this condition of this head muscles, motor neuron attachment. So the neurons coming towards this head muscles, this neck muscles and head muscles, they come out through this midbrain. So already they have this head muscles attachment. And the superior colliculi will take care of the auditory reflex. For example, sound is coming in this side. I want a clarity of that sound. I just rotate my head. And accordingly, the sound waves will go into the ear, external ear and the tympanum and all those things. So auditory reflexes. So midbrain, what it will do is, it will arrange your body. It will arrange your head, we can say, in such a way that you are able to receive the visual signals and the auditory signals properly. That is the main reason. Moreover, this inferior colliculi has more functions in other mammals than us, because we have this ear pinna not working and these muscles which are not working properly, the auricular muscles we can say, are the muscles present below the ear. But in other animals, you can see a cat or a dog who is always rotating their ears to receive the signals. So that is the auditory reflex, where you are trying to get the signals into your brain or into your cortex region. Okay, so that is the main functions of this superior colliculi and inferior colliculi. And one more thing, they will also connect this so-called the lower parts of the brain to the cortex region. And one more thing, we have discussed on the ventricular system also. We have a small duct of the CSF going through this midbrain or going over the midbrain, that is called as aqueduct. Okay, I will discuss them in the ventricular system of the brain. We will discuss that, don't worry. Right now, we are discussing the anatomy. Okay, so this is the proper structure of the midbrain, the corpora quadrigemina, which means the four lobes which look like twins, corpora quadrigemina. And we have superior colliculi, the upper hills like region, and we have the inferior colliculi, lower hills like region. So, upper hills like region and lower hills like region have one common thing, that is, they have the motor nerves going into the head muscles region. And second thing, superior colliculi has the signals coming out from the the nerves coming out to the visual region. So they have visual reflexes under control, and the inferior colliculi has auditory reflexes under control. So what they will do is, they will rotate your head according to the zone or a place where you are able to listen or where you are able to see the things properly. So if you want to see something, you can see that if you, in your mind also, if you think, if you are looking at something, your head and eyes will automatically rotate. So if, for example, my head is still right now, if I want to see in this place, my eyes will automatically rotate without my intention. Yes, we have some voluntary control, that's what, but we also have involuntary control there. So the inner parts of the iris muscles, the pupil, they'll all be focused involuntarily. So that's why we use a word called as visual reflexes. And auditory also, without your knowledge, if you hear some sound from this side, the automatically ear will, the head will rotate. For us, this is not that much important because you don't have these muscles under the ear doing that part. But anyway, your head is rotating to the required part. So it is the main function of the corpora quadrigemina. Okay. So now coming to the second part of midbrain, after corpora quadrigemina, we have the second part, which is called as the crura cerebri. So now the same thing, we'll draw it again, don't worry. So we have gone through the corpora quadrigemina. Corpora is done. Now again we'll go for the same corpus callosum because that's our what you can say the reference part, the corpus callosum, and under the corpus callosum we have this thalamus region, and from the thalamus region we have the hypothalamus, hypothalamus ends as pituitary. That's done.
That's not our problem.
Okay. So I said here we have the corpora quadrigemina. They look like lobes actually. So here we have the pineal body. That's done. So here we have the corpora quadrigemina, like a hills in this region. So that's the side view. But when you observe on the back side, they look like lobes. As I have said, they look like the four lobes, four rounds below the cerebrum, below the cerebrum. Okay. So now we have one more part where all the ganglions of the cerebral cortex will accumulate and form a two thick tracts of nerves. So through this corpus callosum, we can say through the link on the left side and right side. So if I say, for example, if I draw it in another angle, so if you look it from the top, so assume this has a cerebrum, the cerebral hemispheres. Okay, so here we have the corpus callosum, right? Somewhere here we have the midbrain. Somewhere below here we have the midbrains. Okay, so I'm just making it up. Now all the nerves from here, they'll go down, so they have to go down in thick tracts, thick tuft of nerves. So all the nerves from here, they'll form the basal ganglion, if you remember. So here we have corpus callosum, and around it we have the basal ganglions, and all the nerves from the basal ganglions and that the limbic system, everything, all those nerves will come down. They'll come down as these thick tufts. So midbrain is somewhat on the back side like this. So if this is cerebrum, if my hand above hand is cerebrum, we have midbrain here. Okay, so from the midbrain the nerves will go down, right? So we have two thick tufts. Remember this point, two, not one. We have two thick tufts of nerves. So thick tufts of nerves, I can say, I'll write it here. So we can see two thick tufts of, can you use a word called as nerve tracts? Yes, nerve tracts, which are a group of axons. So they will all come down through this hypothalamus. As I said, hypothalamus looks like this. So through this hypothalamus, all those things come down. Okay, they'll come down and join to form the next part of the brainstem. So here we have the pons horoli. From down we have, from here that group will form the pons horoli, and they will form the medulla oblongata also. Now the main thing, from here we have the arising of the cerebellum also. Okay, so that round is actually cerebellum portion. So as I've said, from the cerebral cortex the nerves has to come down, and all those nerves we should contact with the other parts of the brain. So this cerebellum, the part of hind brain, we'll discuss that, don't worry. So from the top part, from here, that is the cerebrum portion, from here the cerebrum portion. Okay, so all the nerves will form the basal ganglion. So on this part we have the basal ganglion. If you remember the limbic system, all those things, we have the system there. Now as I have said, it's a hollow organ. Hypothalamus is a round hollow organ. Through this organ the nerves will come down, the tufts of nerves will come down. Okay, don't think of corpus callosum. Around the corpus callosum they'll come, around it. So if we have corpus callosum, they'll come around it, this side one tract and this side one tract. Okay, so we have a pair of these tufts of nerves which are called as nerve tracts, are called as crura cerebri. Again, when you go for the etymology of this word, crura means legs, cerebri means cerebrum. So what are they? They are the legs of the cerebrum. That's why they are called as cerebral peduncle. They have one more name, cerebral peduncle. So think of it, what is peduncle? In a flower, we have a stalk-like portion at the bottom, peduncle, which is looks like holding all the parts of the flower. But actually here, if you observe this one, this looks like peduncle holding the cerebrum. So in that way, they have just given the word. Cerebral peduncle, also called as crura cerebri. In the Greek language, crura means legs. So they look like cerebri's legs or cerebrum's legs. What they will do? They will carry signals. Obviously, what they don't do anything, they carry signals from the forebrain to hindbrain, or from hindbrain to forebrain. Even they carry the signals to this cerebellum. Okay, so they are just relay centers. So this part of the midbrain, the crura cerebri, they are just simply, I can write here, they are just simply the relay centers. They don't even have any reflex actions. People say that along with the integration of the cerebellum, they also maintain the muscle tone, but not individually. So remember this word, they don't maintain the muscle tone individually. So muscle tone is not maintained individually, but yes, they maintain the muscle tone along with the integration of the cerebellum part, because this is the part which is connecting the cerebrum with the cerebellum. Okay, so the lower parts of the signals is related to the upper parts of the brain, and upper part signals are related to the lower parts of the brain through this cerebral peduncle. And the same cerebral peduncle, along with the integration of cerebellum, because that is the one which is giving the signals, along with cerebellum, it also maintains muscle tones. And some people, I mean, in some books it is given that it has the capacity of maintaining some motor actions, voluntary motor actions, because it is coming from cerebral cortex. Individually, it can also maintain some motor action, but it's not actually completely proven. But people say it also have the capacity to maintain some motor actions by itself, or coordinate some motor actions by itself. And again, same thing. There we have a wrong conception. That is, it is not going to work individually, because it's a tract of axons. Think of it, the tract of axons does not have that much importance there. So along with the cerebellar hemisphere, or we can cerebellar coordination, they do this works, the maintenance of muscle tones and all those things, but that's not discussed more. So simple thing, crura cerebri is a leg of the cerebrum where all the nerves will come down, and all those nerves will go on and form the lower parts of the brain. So we have the pons horali, we have the medulla oblongata, and from down they'll form the spinal cord. Okay, so this is the midbrain. So this is the dorsal region, the posterior part of brain, we can say, or the dorsal part of the head. Okay, the dorsal is having the corpora quadrigemina, and we have the tract. So it's not that much important, but yes, it has some important parts to discuss, because if you don't understand these parts, you don't know from where these pons orally came, or you don't know how the signals will go from the upper to lower. So we think that there is an obstacle, the epithalamus and the thalamus are the obstacles. No, so below this thalamus, or we can say posterior to thalamus, we have this midbrain. And all the tracts also, they have the capacity to pass through the hypothalamus, and they form the crura cerebri, that is the legs of the cerebrum. So all the signals will come down. That's for today. So in the next video, what we'll do is we'll try to understand the hindbrain, which is a big one. So in hindbrain, I'll try to finish at least two of the things in the next video. Hope you are all understanding these videos. Thank you very much for supporting. Mohan Krishna signing off.